Welcome, everyone. We are very happy to have so many people spending a Saturday afternoon with us. My name is Emily Badix, and I am the Associate Director at the Longmore Institute on Disability at San Francisco State University. And we are very pleased to be presenting this program with the Disability Visibility Project, as both of our two organizations share a passion for disability storytelling and drawing more conversation around some of the marginalized conversations inside of disability. And so it is just an honor to get to work with Alice and promote the incredible book that she edited, Disability Visibility. Just a few access notes and Zoom tips before we get started. Oh, and I'll also just do a quick audio description of myself. I am a Caucasian woman with my hair up in a high bun and a bright orange shirt today, and maybe a bit frizzy hair. Okay, next slide, please. For captioning, you can use the CC button at the bottom, and there is, Zoom has actually just recently done an update. I just am playing around with and discovering where you now have control of your captioning, and it can be a bit more personalized. But still, Zoom is, you know, always sort of working out some of the kinks, and we know that some of our users prefer to use stream text. So we've posted the stream text link. I'm not going to repeat it aloud because it's sent in the email that we sent to you just in the past hour, and then it's also just being chatted. If you'd like to ask a question, or if you just want to connect with community, share your thoughts, like, you know, echo your excitement about hopefully some of the things that our presenters are saying, go ahead and use the Q&A box to do that. The chat box is a little bit flawed access-wise, so we've been using the Q&A box as a space for that. If you're joining us by phone, or, you know, using the Q&A box is too daunting, you also have the option to send any questions that you might like the panelists to ask by email to beitiks@sfsu.edu. And that's the same email that would have sent the reminder. So you can even just go find that and reply to that. A note that this event is being filmed, so if you have to sign off early, we'll be sharing it on YouTube. Next slide. This slide has all of our social media handles. I'm not going to read those aloud because it's a mouthful, but again, these were posted in the email and also have been shared in the chat. We do encourage you to join the conversation on Twitter with the hashtag DisabilityVisibility. With that, I am very excited to pass it off to Vilissa, our moderator today. Vilissa Thompson, if you can turn your video on as well as all of our other panelists for some introductions before we get this conversation further started. And we can stop our slideshow.
Thank you, Emily. As Emily stated, my name is Vilissa Thompson, and I am your moderator for today's panel. I am very excited to be here and be in part of an incredible conversation. I'm a licensed social worker, activist, writer, public speaker, and consultant. I'm the founder of Wrap Your Voice and the creator of the Disability2White hashtag. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm going to give an audio description of myself. I am a light-skinned Black woman who is sitting in her wheelchair. I am wearing a short-sleeved Black shirt with thin gold hoop earrings. I have on small rectangular-shaped glasses, a dark reddish purple lip, and my long brown hair is hanging down my back, and behind me is wooden paneling on the wall. I'm going to pass it to our panelists to introduce themselves, starting with Keah.
Hi, first of all, thank you for having me. For people who don't know me, my name is Keah Brown. I'm an author, a journalist, and a screenwriter. I wrote the book, The Pretty One, on life, pop culture, disability, and other reasons to fall in love with me, which is available for purchase now. I also created the hashtag Disabled and Cute, and I'm currently working on a novel and my first screenplay. So that's fun. I am going to do an audio description of myself. I am a Black woman wearing a red lipstick with black round glasses and my black hair pulled into a ponytail. Behind me is a teal greenish curtain, and then behind that is a tan door, and I am sitting in a black desk chair.
Brittany.
Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here. Thank you for having me. My name is Brittany Wilson. My pronouns are she, her. I'm a civil rights attorney, writer, and artist from Brooklyn, New York. For my audio description, I'm a brown / dark-skinned black woman with curly black hair. I have black rectangular-shaped glasses on, and I have a red shirt on. I'm sitting in a room with green walls and a painting of The Last Supper behind me. And really excited to be here.
Very excited, Brittany. And Alice?
Hey, everybody. What a great event. I have just, this is the highlights of the event to look forward to for quite a few weeks. Thank you all for being here. My name is Alice Wong. I am the founder and director of the Disability Visibility Project, which is an online community dedicated to creating, sharing, and amplifying the disability media culture. And as you heard earlier, I am the editor of a new anthology titled Disability Visibility, First Person Stories from the 21st Century, which is published by Vintage Books that came out this past summer. And yes, I don't describe myself. I am an Asian American disabled woman with very short black hair. I have a mask over my nose attached to a gray tube, which goes with my ventilator. I'm wearing a dark navy hoodie, and I'm in a darkened room, so basically it's very black right behind me.
Hey, well, we're going to get started first with the conversation with Alice, who is, as Emily stated, the editor of this amazing book. And Alice, I want to ask you, what was your motivation in developing this compilation of essays?
Well, there's a lot of motivations. I first want to give a shout out to Catherine Tung, T-U-N-G. At the time, Catherine reached out to me, I believe the summer of 2018, to just email me out of the blue, saying, hey, I'm an editor at Vintage. Are you interested in editing an anthology? Do you have any ideas? And I'm like, well, yes, I do have a few ideas. And that just started the entire process of having conversations about it, developing a book proposal. But I think for me, this was an opportunity to share disability culture from this moment in time. And I really wanted to highlight not just the diversity, but the brilliance of disabled people. And again, this is really by the personal perspective of how I see the brilliance all around me and with the people that I'm connected to. And also, putting together stories that really, I think, are a little bit deeper, a little bit more challenging. I do believe that variety is incredibly important for an anthology. And that's the really wonderful thing about anthologies, is to have such a spectrum of perspectives and writing styles. Mm-hmm. And just, people really being authentic and telling their stories in their own words. And I think we still don't have enough of that in our, mainstream culture. Right. And I think this is my opportunity to really center it on us. And it's very rare to see this kind of book published by a major publisher with a disabled editor. And I think that to me, you know, is one of the main things that makes a difference from other existing books. So hopefully this is one contribution to this growing body of work by disabled people in publishing.
That's great. And, you know, and cueing the whole body of work with people, you know, is our panel of the day with two of the folks who had pieces in your book. What moved you to create this panel series? You know, create the panel series for the day and the series in general.
Well, you know, I thought a lot about, what if this was by only shot? Like, this is, what if this is the first and maybe last book I'll ever publish? How do I leverage this? You know, how do I make the most out of this for us, for our community? So I thought, okay, we could do a series of book events, but really, you know, it doesn't have to be about the book itself, but really as a springboard for broader conversations. And that's exactly why I was thinking, you know, the concept and the importance of Black disabled joy, you know, really thinking about Keah's essay, which really was about this topic, and how in this time in particular, but always, you know, Black disabled joy is something that we need more of in the world. So this was just an opportunity for the contributors and, you know, all of us who are participating online to come together and learn from one another. And, you know, this is not to say I am like an expert anyway, but I am here to create this space for all of us. And I'm here to learn and also just absorb the beauty and the brilliance here.
And when it comes to observing the beauty, you are well aware of the meaning of disability to white. What should attendees take away from listening to Black disabled voices and strategizing how to create spaces for these perspectives?
Well, you know, I think this is, you know, I don't know if I would like to talk about, you know, all this, like, what, why do I want people to get away from this, because I just hope they see maybe my intentions and my actions as what I believe in. You know, I think this is what's hopefully people can take away, is that we all have the capacity, if we really dream to be allies or co-conspirators, if we really do be Black Lives Matter, you know, there are ways to show this rather than to say it, you know, and I feel like hopefully folks who are participating just see this and maybe just be inspired by it. You know, we can all do different things in different ways to really show our values through our actions, not just through our words. And I try really hard not to make this a performative thing. So I think hopefully that will just be, this itself right now, to us being together is a statement in itself. And I do want to say that it is a little ironic that we still have to, you know, to bring up how disability is so overwhelmingly white. I just want to, you know, I still laugh a little bit, and laughing in a very sad way, that this past July I had another online event with the Longmore Institute featuring a series of essays by disabled people of color called ADA 30 in Color, looking back and looking forward, you know, about what is disability rights and justice from the perspective of disabled people of color. And unfortunately, during the chat function, I didn't realize this, but there were white disabled people who kept saying, why do we have to keep talking about race? Why are we bringing up racism? And I'm like, wow, like, y'all came to this event knowing what it was about, hearing other disabled people of color, and this is what you have to say. So the work remains. I feel like, you know, it's very tiresome in this sense because I still can't believe that we have to, like, make the argument for this. But here we are. And I think as we just keep doing what we're doing, keep putting a spotlight on all the different groups within the disability community that have been left out, excluded, marginalized, silenced, gaslit. That's, you know, something that hopefully all of us are going to do collectively, those who really do care. And I think that's, this is one effort out of many.
And on that note, I really feel like that's a very lasting word for us to do care, and we should. And it's overdue that we do care, and not just care, but actually take action. So thank you, Alice, for creating this space.
Well, I'm here. I'm excited just for this conversation, and I will now bow out. And here we go.
All right. Get this show on the road. Come on. These beautiful, beautiful people before me today. I am very excited to be in a community with Brittany and Keah. So why don't we get this show on the road with our first question? What does Black joy, Black disabled joy, excuse me, mean to each of you? Why don't we start with Brittany?
Yeah, I really had to think about this question because if we're being honest, when Alice first asked me to join this particular panel, I was a little bit surprised just because my essay in her book, spoiler alert for anybody who hasn't read it, and possible trigger warning, is actually about sexual assault. And I was just like, so that's not exactly a joyful topic. And I don't know that people wouldn't necessarily describe me as joyful. And that sounds horrible to say, but I would describe myself that way. But I guess I started thinking about the ways that I've begun to internalize some of the ways that I'm characterized sometimes and stereotyped out in the world. And so while I know myself, I was just like, wow, like what does joy mean? Am I joyful? Do I present myself that way? And so I think Black disabled joy to me means being and the right to be, whoever that is, whoever you are in the moment. And I think we all know as disabled people and as Black disabled people that disability is an integral part of our identity. We'll never be able to separate ourselves from it, but it doesn't mean that every aspect of who we are has to be about that, if that makes sense. And I think sometimes, especially as a semi-public disabled figure, even on my Twitter account, I'm like, oh, I'm not tweeting about disability enough. Like, I'm tweeting about this basketball game. Is that not a good thing? And I think that Black disabled joy means the right to be you in all aspects of who you are. And I if I could steal from Keah, like, I love the line in the essay where you're like, I'm going to butcher it, but it's something like, you know, I want to leave this world knowing that the world knows that I chose to live. And that's exactly it.
All right.
Brittany, you took the words right out of my mouth.
I know. Right. Hard to follow up right there, boy.
That's what I did with that.
You but did yeah, that.
No, you're literally, I feel the exact same way. I feel like many things, joy takes a lot of effort. And so when I do work or exist in the world, I'm putting joy first. And for me, Black disabled joy in particular just means not apologizing for the space that I take up. I spent so many years apologizing for, you know, what I felt was being too big, you know, showing too much of myself, this idea that like disability somehow needed to be hidden. and I didn't need to show my hand, or I needed to make sure that when I walked away from someone, they didn't see me move, they didn't see me leave, so they wouldn't see me limp. And it's just, for me, Black Disabled Joy is about being unapologetic and saying, I'm here, and whether you like it or not, this is what you're gonna get. Like, if you don't like it, turn the channel. If you do, stay. You know, we got a whole program coming. And that's just the way that I've decided to choose joy and what joy means to me, is just really being all that I am, coming to the table with every aspect of me. So like disabled, queer, a woman, et cetera, et cetera. All these things coming with them and saying, this is what you're gonna get. I'm not apologizing, take it or leave it. So yeah, we're on the same page.
Most definitely. And for me, it just means living by my own rules, defining what being a Black disabled woman looks like, and releasing and rejecting the projections that is thrust upon us in these bodies, with this experience, with these identities. I think at 35, you know, I think I'm understanding what it's like to be free in this body, you know, and being confident, loving myself, you know, being in a community with amazing people like the two of you, and just really seeing different representations of myself and knowing that A, we're not alone. B, there's nothing wrong with these bodies and these minds that we possess and the way that we navigate the world. And what's wrong is how the world misunderstands on purpose most times who we are, what we are, and what we're about. So I think the older I've gotten, you know, especially with this work, it has empowered me to really define what is being a Black disabled person, a Black disabled woman, and also shaping what does it mean to have Black disabled joy. Because joy should not be considered a luxury for us. We have a right to experience joy. We have a right to feel joy. We have a right to bask in it, no matter what it is, whether it's something small as in we just woke up in a good mood, to something big that we nailed an incredible accomplishment. You know, we have the right to experience Black disabled joy and to have that joy respected in all communities, whether it's queer community, the disabled community, the Black community. Everybody knows that our joy matters too. Yes. Right. Now, so we talked about what is Black joy, what it means to us. In what ways have you captured Black disabled joy in the middle of a pandemic, as well as with the uprisings that have continued well into the fall? How are you caring for you? Keah, why don't we start with you this time?
Okay. A lot of the ways that I'm caring for myself is honestly taking days off. I'm a person who fully believes too much that my worth is tied to productivity. And like, if I'm not writing an essay or working on another book or the screenplay, then I'm not doing something that needs to be done. And so lately, at least during the pandemic anyway, I've really, you know, in therapy, thank God for therapy, I decided that I needed to take time for myself. I needed to take time to not do work and to just have a day be busy without it being busy from work. And that's how I've been really taking care of myself on that front. That and like just listening to the things I want to listen to, like podcasts and music, and checking in on my friends. And literally what has saved me this pandemic in terms of joy is talking to you and Rebecca and Alice, and just really letting myself do the things that make me happy without feeling like I need to like explain it away to people or say, you know, I can do this thing for 10 minutes, but that's it. Then I got to get back to work. And it's like, no, none of that. Sometimes you just need days where you do nothing. And that's what I've been learning in the pandemic. And that's what's been bringing me joy.
Ooh. Yes. I can relate to that a lot. I think that's a function of ableism, right? We tie our self-worth to our productivity because it's like, look, wait, I'm supposed to be here. You need me. I'm valuable. Mm-hmm. So I think we as disabled people, and as Black disabled people especially, do that. We tie our sense of worth to our productivity. I'm very guilty of that. And I'm actively trying to unlearn that. And I say that to say, I'm not very good at self-care. And I know that I need to get better at it. But what I've been trying to do during the pandemic to take care of me, I have not taken enough days off, that's a fact. But what I've been trying to do to take care of me is little things like, well, I guess not a little thing, but my two of my nieces, every Friday, they FaceTime me to read with me. And sometimes we don't read. Sometimes we just talk about their week. They're in virtual school. They're 5 and 6. And that's usually the highlight of my week, is just chatting with them. And I'm a huge basketball fan, so I've been enjoying the NBA and the bubble. Even though I was a little opposed to it at first, I'm actually really glad that they're back. So I've been watching the finals. I'm not a huge TV person. I have like a couple key TV shows that I usually watch, but I think now I've been wandering into a little bit more random TV shows, but I also rewatching my favorites. I'm a big This Is Us fanatic, so I've been watching This Is Us reruns. I don't know, I'm probably like the only person that watches This Is Us to feel joy, but I've been watching This Is Us reruns. I've been watching like PS to all the Boys I Loved Before on Netflix.
Yes.
Like, just little stuff that like will take my mind to other places. So yeah, that's self-care.
Oh, that's awesome. You know, to mirror what you all have said, you know, the unplugging has been key, and the self-care, you know, as a social worker, you know, I understand self-care from, you know, my educational background, but to put it in practice is hard, similar to what you were saying, Brittany, because, and also Keah, you know, we feel like we have to be there. And that's kind of the projection of Black women and families feel like we have to be there for everybody, but we're not there for ourselves. And if our cup is empty, how can we give to anybody? So I think that's been very intentional for me during this year with the pandemic and with the uprisings, figuring out how can I be there with the tools that I have, but also respect my limits as a person, you know, as a human, because I'm not a superwoman, you know, nor should I place myself in positions to be treated as such. And also that means for me, boundaries. You know, I know I've had several people reach out to me and say, well, you're really good at your boundaries. I'm like, well, when you've been bad about boundaries and the order you get, you realize having boundaries is priority. So for me, you know, self-care is about stating my boundaries, what I'm willing to engage with, whether conversations or with certain people, or also understanding different relationship patterns. You know, is it healthy for me? Am I giving more than receiving? You know, taking that type of self inventory. And also unplugging from online, since online can be very intense, depends on the news cycle. I think we kind of been feeling that over the past few weeks. I think that's probably an understatement. And just taking in what I need and then leaving the rest and not feeling selfish from that, particularly as the world has continuous fires. I think that's something that's been very much a practice for me in retaining my Black disabled joy and also not feeling bad when good things happen. Yeah, I think sometimes when there's a whole lot of chaos, there's still good things happen. You know, I see it from Keah, I see it from you, Brittany, you know, that we have so many good things that we're doing on a personal level and a professional level that really we need to celebrate and just understand that there's nothing wrong with celebrating ourselves and capturing that joy, because that keeps us going. So just understanding what joy means is not just a feeling, but also in some ways of movement to sustain oneself in all of these moving parts that we see. And speaking of moving parts, being Black, disabled, and family is a beautiful experience that the world fails to uplift, protect, and respect. The last one is key, respect. There are few media representations of us out there that displays these truths well. What has been the driving force for you to create the imagery not only you want or need, but the young people nipping at our heels can have? Either one of you can start.
I guess for me, I always say this, like, it's weird. I'm a writer first. I think a lot of people don't really know that about me. Like those are my roots. I've been writing probably since I was 11, seriously. Like first had a poems published in like a children's anthology. So since I was young, I've loved to write. I have a background in spoken word. I did a show on HBO back in the day called Brave New Voices. But nowadays, like, a lot of people know me as the lawyer, but first I'm the writer. And I didn't really do that for others. I very much did it for me, because I needed to be able to express myself and to figure out what was going on in the world around me. And so it wasn't so much like I had a sense of lack of imagery. I guess I knew that I didn't see myself, but I wasn't thinking about it like that at the time. I just knew that I needed to figure out how to tell my stories and how to figure out what was going on. So that's how it started. And I think, like, I love to read, and I think Anne Frank said something like, patience, paper has more patience than people. And that's always been my MO and why I always write things down. And that's really how my voice as a writer started.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's different. I, like you, I grew up writing. It was always this thing that I loved doing, but I really, first I started because I loved it, but then I looked around and I didn't see myself. And for so long I wanted to hide, so I didn't need to see myself. You know, I was like, I don't want to see anybody who looks like me because then it'll make this real. And it wasn't until I was in high school, maybe, that I decided that I wanted to do this as a career, but also that I wanted to see myself because I felt like I deserved to be seen. And so a lot of the work that I do now and in my talks about representation and how, like, it's not the only thing we need, but I do think that it's very important. Like, that, those conversations happen because I am exhausted with seeing the same narratives of disability constantly. Like, sure, the stories are valuable, but we're not all white male wheelchair users who hate themselves and want to date a girl who is non-disabled and doesn't love them back and just wants to be their friend. And I don't want to keep seeing that. And I don't want to keep seeing shows and movies where we die before the credits roll. And I just got tired of waiting for somebody else to do it. So I started doing it myself. I said, hey, Keah, you love rom-coms, you love TV and film, like, use what you love as research. And then I started putting pen to paper because I got tired of waiting for somebody else to. And I got tired of complaining to people about how terrible these narratives are. And then them saying, well, you know, what are we supposed to do about it? We don't have access to writers with disabilities who know X, Y, and Z. So I just honestly took it on in part because I didn't want another Black disabled girl or woman to grow up not seeing herself, if I could do something about it.
I want to dive a little bit what you just said, Keah, about representation, because I have stopped watching disability representation that is white male cisgender centered, because I just don't want to see another white disabled male story. Because it's the same story, just a different show, different movies, same nonsense, same woe is me, I want the hot girl doesn't think that I'm hot because I'm crippled, woe is me, I don't want to see that. You know, like, that doesn't represent me, first off, from the character itself, but also that doesn't represent the life that I have. You know, and there's more diversity that we need in storytelling and representation from books to film, to shows, to screenplays, to everything else. So thank you for bringing it up, because I think it ties into, you know, that lack of representation ties into our community's failure of understanding how whiteness overruns the narrative of disability. And how those of us who are not white don't have that representation and don't feel a part of the community. And as Black people, we know the resistance of Black people claiming disability, saying the word, having it as an identity. And I really want people to understand that that lack of visibility runs deep for many of us.
Absolutely. Yeah, I feel like people don't realize that you can't, everybody wants to talk about the bigger picture, but they never want to talk about how race impacts disability, specifically within the community. I find that people are like, well, this is a great step in the white, in the right direction, but really just for white disabled people. Mm-hmm. Because if we're not in the room and all you're doing is telling stories where some white guy hates himself, what does that do for me? Nothing. It doesn't give me any hope that I could see myself on screen one day. What it says instead is, hey, these white disabled people, their stories are valuable, but not yours, because you don't exist. Because right now in mainstream culture, we're a myth. We don't,
right.
They don't see us. They're not checking for us. We're not telling stories about how we're cute and sexy and fun and attractive. Like, I like girls too, but the point is that it's not the same narrative
right.
for people like us that it is for them, because it doesn't even acknowledge the privilege that comes with being white on top of disabled, and the places they have access to, and all these things are never acknowledged, and that's a problem. Like you said,
it is.
Yeah, I also think that Black media forms need to really tackle ableism, and mm-hmm. we talk about, like, you know, rom-coms and things like that. Like, there's this narrative of hashtag Black love that disabled people are completely left out of. And I think that's really crucial, but that's a whole other conversation.
No, but that's really a part of the conversation too, you know, mm-hmm. because our own community, the Black community, fails to see us as sexual beings, as romantic beings, and to broaden the storyline of the Black experience, you know, and that erasure or omission is just as problematic as the erasure and omission within the disability storytelling and invisibility. So they, you know, they're cousins, you know, in a way, you know, when it comes to the nonsense, they're cousins in that. And mm-hmm. kind of digging a little deeper into the disability community, we understand misogynoir, we understand anti-Blackness. And I think that's something we need to tackle too, about how the racism and the lack of wanting to focus on that in the community, you know, allows the nonsense to breed unapologetically, kind of similar to what Alice has said at the beginning, you know, and I kind of want us to kind of talk about a little bit too, you know, how does racism in this community impact our Black joy and the representation that we need?
Woo. Well, to start, I keep my circle small on purpose, because mm-hmm. what happens is, when I first started to come into myself, into my disabled identity, and I said this in my book, the first thing was, I learned to love other disabled people before I learned to love myself as a disabled person. Vilissa, you were one of those people. And for me, it was like, oh, this is so exciting, like, to be a part of this community. I felt like a kid at Christmas. I was like, this is so wonderful. And then I got deeper into the community. I tried to make my circle bigger. And I found out that a whole bunch of disabled white people are racist as all get out. They hate when you talk about race. They hate when you talk about sexuality. They're like, listen, we're all one. And it's like, but that's not the way the world works. And so for me, the way racism is in the disability community forces me to be like, let me go back to my small circle and mind my business, keep my head down and do the work, because I can't take too much time trying to change minds that don't want to change. And it's frustrating, because these things come from people who should already understand how exhausting it is to be oppressed. Yet here they are oppressing other people in the community because they're uncomfortable with the idea that they have privilege in their lived oppressed experiences. And that's, to me, it's just, I find it exhausting to constantly have to say, okay, but there's another layer to disability. I'm Black and I'm queer. Do you know how many spaces I won't be in that you'll be able to get in? And it's not just issue of accessibility, which is important. It's an issue of the fact that so many of these disabled spaces that say that they care about all disabled people are run by racist people who don't get checked because they're doing good for the community when the community is just white disabled people.
Speak on it. Speak on it.
Go ahead, Britney. That out.
Wow. I think, where do I start? I think it impacted me in many ways, on many levels. So I think professionally, I'm going to start there. So I'm a civil rights attorney, like I said, and I think in advocacy spaces, and especially in all advocacy spaces, but I think particularly in the disability advocacy space as well, people think that because they work for or serve the disability community, that they can speak for us, understand us, know us, et cetera, et cetera. Like, people pride themselves on having that, like, we're a specialized knowledge base that they have. And I think it's like saviorism plus when it comes to the disability community, because we know that white saviorism exists in regular social justice spaces, but, you know, we're already a quote unquote marginalized, vulnerable population by definition. So I think the people that serve us have a whole other brand of saviorism going on. So there's that. And I think a lot of, again, in the advocacy space, we like to compare struggles. And I think you get into, it can be useful in certain contexts, but you also get into some trouble. You start comparing, like, disability rights movement to the movement for racial justice and the civil rights movement and the women's rights movement. And it's like, yes, there are points of comparison, but that also tends to ignore the intersections. And everybody wants to, you know, say, like, well, we had the same fight. No, we didn't have the same fight. Some of us, we're all still fighting, but some of us have to fight with multiple layers of oppression. So I see it in personal space and in the professional space. And I think it's interesting because you see now a lot of people are they've heard us talk before. They've heard people like us say these sorts of things. And so now they're becoming conscious of it. So you hear people like adopting the jargon, but not really changing their actual practices and philosophies. And I think that's a little bit difficult. And then just on a personal realm, I mean, like, I've actually had my physical safety and well-being jeopardized because people don't understand the intersections of race and disability. I've been acting in my lawyer capacity, and I do a lot of policing work, and been put in harm's way as a disabled person because I'm also Black. Like, you have to think about that, right? When I go do certain things, I'm not just a disabled person going to have these interactions. I'm a Black disabled person. And so I think there's just so many ways. And then just the racism, like, I've had, like, snide white disabled people say things to me like, oh, I heard you're a lawyer. Like, I'm a lawyer too, but I didn't go to as fancy a school as you did. That's racism. Like, you know, that's thinly veiled racism. I deal with that sort of stuff all the time. And so, yeah, I could go on and on, but you get the picture.
Oh yeah, like, those microaggressions run deep, you know, within and outside of the community. I know when I created the hashtag Disability Too White, that was the first time in my life I was ever called the N-word. And I was called the N-word by majority white disabled folks. So I have a very big bone to pick with white disabled folks not understanding how they are oppressors in this space, you know, with their refusal to acknowledge racism, their refusal to acknowledge their white privilege, and also how they take up space. White disabled people take up a hell of a lot of space, you know, from the leadership to, you know, being on panels about intersectionality, and your track record is not very good. Mm-hmm. And, you know, other experiences to where white disabled people need to pass the mic, need to sit down, need to give up their seat at the table, and also give up their money too. Because you all, you know, get money easily, you know, from your organizations, from just being yourself, and not understanding how that trickle down doesn't really come easy for some of us, you know, and we work just as hard, if not harder, because of the barriers that exist for us to get through the door. Hell, even just get to the door, not even through the door, to the door, close to the door, may not even be able to touch it yet, you know, but, you know, just not understanding how your whiteness has allowed you to access things easily, even if you may have had it hard to some degree. But your whiteness is a badge that lets people know that your identity matters more than somebody else. And understanding how that white privilege, particularly in America, works. And also outside of America too. Because some of the most racist white disabled people I have encountered have been non-American. So understanding how Black people across the diaspora experience white disabled people has been an experience as well. You know, particularly for those of us in westernized countries, and how they too, particularly our fam in the diaspora, are saying the same thing that we are here. Mm-hmm. And the refusal to acknowledge whiteness is very startling, particularly when you're in countries where whiteness has dominated, has enslaved, have stolen, have killed the people that are there or were brought there. So I think that white disabled people to feign ignorance is just ridiculous at this point. It's been ridiculous the whole time, but really understanding how whiteness has really allowed the disabled community and the movement to not be as robust as it should be, for our history to not be as well known, particularly our Black disabled ancestors, for them not to be as big names as some of the white disabled folks, it's a shame. And for us to not know about the ancestors until we do this work should not be the case. We should know about the disabilities of ancestors like Fannie Lou Hamer and Harriet Tubman and, you know, those at the start of the independent living movement, as we do other names, you know, within those same realms. So, you know, the racism and anti-Blackness really has shaped this community in ways that has warped the understanding of what disability is for all of us.
Yeah, last week I saw a poster for a panel on disability and inclusivity, and it was literally all white disabled people. And I was like, does no one see the issue here, or is it just me? I mean, and they were promoting it like it was, they were like, this is wonderful, us doing this on this big platform. And I wanted to be like that Jessica Williams gif that was like, but where are the Black people? because it's like, and it's like people that should know better. But they're like, listen, I don't want to stop my bag. Let me just do this all white panel. And it's like, for me, when you get to a certain point in your career and you look around and you're doing these panels, you should be the one to say, no, I don't want to do an all white panel. I don't want to do a panel that just has people that look like me on it, because that's not true inclusion. Just because you're disabled or you're a parent of a person who's disabled, which is another thing, doesn't mean that you should be taking up the space from the person who lives in that actual experience. And I'm sorry, but four white people on one panel is not diversity and inclusion when you're completely ignoring the fact that Black people are disabled, Asian people are disabled, like Hispanic people are disabled. So many people are disabled. And the fact that you could turn around and say, I'm doing this panel of four other white people, and that's diversity and inclusion, it's just wild to me.
Yeah, and that shows a lack of, just a lack of consciousness, you know, of what you're doing and the failure to use that white privilege. Now, you have white privilege, use it. If that means that you have to turn down opportunity, then that's what you do. You know, like, you can't, this whole scarcity mindset that we have is why we are having these exact conversations, because we're so scared that, oh, we're not going to get another opportunity to be on a panel or at an event. There's always stuff there. But if you are a white person and you see everybody's name on a list and it's all white people, you need to say something. That's on you to say something. Because these organizers of these events, they're not thinking about that. They're just trying to pick names for whatever event that they're hosting. But you, as the white activist, especially if you've been in this work for a very long time, you definitely don't get a pass. No one gets a pass, really. But you definitely don't get a pass if you have been here for a very long time to still do the same nonsense over and over again. Because we see you. Don't act like we don't.
I also think it's deeper than representation, because it affects what we can get done as a community. Even I'm always thinking in terms of advocacy, but like, it's not just the need to have disabled people of color represented. It's the fact that racism and ableism and capitalism and economic, all these structural isms are connected. So if you are trying to dismantle ableism, you can't do that without addressing racism and how race, you know, stereotypes about race play into notions of ability, which affect the way you're treated in society. So it's like, it's not even just, oh, we want a seat at the table. It's like, no, in order to deconstruct the table and really figure out what's going on, you have to understand how race, how gender, all these different forces work together.
Exactly. And that also means allowing new voices to come into play too, because we need those new perspectives. You know, one thing I love is learning about what activists, you know, particularly of Generation Z, how they feel. But their experience is different from those of us who are millennials and those of us who are Gen X, you know, because they're, you know, pretty much they're all tech generation. So really understanding how ableism works for them is key. So, you know, making room is just about giving space, giving opportunity for those who are not seen and visible and just getting started, you know, in the work. But I know we've been passionately talking about this, but I'm gonna go get us back on track with these questions a little bit. Starting with Keah, you stated that your joy is your freedom. How do you nurture that joy in a world that tells you that joy is a luxury and not a right to possess?
Ooh, yes, love that. I do several things. One, again, I try my best not to apologize for taking up space or for needing accommodations or for, you know, being all that I am. And so for me, it's like, joy is my freedom, because for the first time in my life at 29, really, you know, from my journey with Disabled and Cute in 2017 to now, I feel my most free. I feel like, you know, especially since last year, I came out a year ago tomorrow, I feel like I'm my most free, my most confident, my most certain in ways that I have never been in my entire life. And literally, that's just because I stopped saying, let me stop trying to please people who don't get it, won't get it, and don't need to get it. You know, I think for so long, I was treating my lived experience and my way in the world as like, let me just, you know, do what I can to make as many people happy as possible. Like, let me do what I can to be as likable and to be as fun and fancy free as possible, so that no one ever feels like I'm ruffling too many feathers. But for me, I think I turned 29 and I was like, oh, that's over. Like, that's done. I just have to do what I want to do and not be bothered by the fact that there are going to be people who don't like me for whatever reason, you know, because for so long I was so like desperate to be liked. And so for me, looking at joy as freedom is really just me looking at joy as this way to say I'm happy now, and I don't have to be sad because that's what you expect me to be, and I don't have to be anything else that no one that someone else thinks I should be. I can just be who I want to be. I can be sad, happy, whatever. But my freedom comes from my ability to make that decision for myself.
Girl, she has said a word. Whew. All right, Brittany. In your essay, you described a scene that was relatable, being at the mercy of a person who did something incredibly inappropriate and not knowing how to react or respond to it in that moment. The stripping of power and being frozen in that moment is all too real. How do you view that situation years later?
That was 3.5 years ago now. It happened in June of 2017. I think how I view it now, I've taken some of my power back. I, in the moment, and like, again, sorry, spoiler alert for anyone who hasn't read the essay, I think one thing I've done is I'm now calling it sexual assault, because I looked it up, and it was a form of sexual assault. I'm an attorney, and so part of me knew that, but I think there was like a certain reluctance I had of calling it that. Just recognizing that there are degrees of that, but part of what I tried to convey in the essay is that in that moment, I was very much afraid, and again, trigger warning, of him physically assaulting me, of raping me. I knew that I didn't want to, if I had called the police, like there's some of my family members after the fact were like, you should call the police, or like, I knew that that wasn't what I wanted to do. Because he ultimately urinated in front of me, and like, I knew, I was like, that's not gonna go anywhere, first of all, in the legal system, and because I'm part of, I work in the legal system, I didn't want any parts of it, and I knew how it was gonna go, but I knew that, like, I wanted to address it some kind of way, and so the essay was my way of addressing it. And so many people see that essay as an essay about accessoride and paratransit. And it is, and that's what I wanted it to be. But really what I wanted it to be was a story about the intersections of race, gender, power, class, all of those things. And so that experience took some of my sense of safety. I think as Black women, we don't generally have an inherent sense of safety to begin with, but like I have to, something like that happened to me on that service, but then I still had to take it to work. I still had to regularly use it. And so like, I don't go to sleep on paratransit anymore. You know, even if I'm on there for hours, it changes the way that I use rideshare services. So I think this is a long answer, but I think the way I view it now is, talking about it, writing about it, and choosing to deal with it in that way has allowed me to take some of my power back and to shape the narrative around it.
No, that is really important, taking that power back. And that kind of goes into our last question. As Black disabled femmes, we know all too well the danger that could present itself if we call out the actions and behaviors of offenders, similar to what you were saying, Brittany. Being forced silent, it's just as harmful, yet sometimes it means putting our safety before anything else. What are ways that we have learned to resolve this contradictory stance?
I mean, I guess I'll go. it's hard. I don't think that I figured it out quite yet. I think that I'm still working on it. When I did the Today Show, I had interviews lined up before the Today Show that had nothing to do with the Today Show. And I did this interview, and this guy kept, like, for the interview, he kept, you know, making suggestions about how, if we were alone in the room, what would I do? And all these things about how I should be open to dating older men. And there is this whole, and I was just so uncomfortable, and no one was saying anything. And he literally spent the entire interview sexually harassing me. And I really struggled after that, because I had to go to the Today Show. I mean, I had to do another thing after that immediately. And so I struggled on the way there because I kept thinking about how uncomfortable he made me and how nobody said anything. And because he's a disabled man, I didn't want to say anything. I was like, you know, he's disabled. And so like, let me not say anything. And honestly, much like Brittany's essay, I felt like I got my power back when I wrote about it. Even though I didn't see the light of day anywhere, I got my power back when I wrote about it. And I think for me, grappling with the idea of silence being safety, or, you know, being more safe than saying something out loud at all, that to me, just being able to get it out on the page, even though, you know, it didn't go anywhere, made me feel like I could move forward. And sometimes we don't have to say anything publicly, like we don't have to name names publicly, because that's not going to help us. And so we have to do whatever it is to help us and our well-being and our future. And now it's like, if somebody asks, I'll tell them the story. But I also think that, like, for me, what I've learned from that experience is just that it's a valid thing that I went through. I don't have to be like, oh, this didn't count for something or whatever. And that me knowing what happened and writing it down, and it's somewhere in a file on my computer, is enough. If that if that actually answers the question.
No, it is. You know, doing whatever that makes you feel good, you know, and like you have that power back, that is enough. That is enough. And you stripping that power from them and regaining it back, that's, you know, sometimes that's all you can do and sometimes all you should do.
You all froze for me, am I?
We hear you, Brittany.
Oh, okay, you froze for a second, I think. But for me, I guess my favorite, one of my favorite writers, Zora Neale Hurston, she said, if you're silent about your pain, they'll kill you and say you enjoyed it. And so I try to live my life like, listen, I might die in the process, but you're gonna know I'm not happy about this, you know? And I take that approach to everything, professionally as well, even though that comes with a whole bunch of risks. Like, I'm gonna say this. It might be uncomfortable, it might be risky, but I'm gonna let you know how I feel. Even if I don't expect this to change or you to do anything about it, I just wanna register the complaint so that you know that it's not okay. And so that's how I make sure that I'm not being forced into silence. Even if in the moment I might have to be, or if I have to change up the way that I respond to something, I'm going to let you know that it's not okay.
You know, I think that's the thing I've learned too, just speaking up. I think of something that Keah had said earlier in, you know, the question I was just with her about, you know, being 29 and just finding that, you know, the courage to be bold and speaking on what you need. I think the older you get, you know, at 35, I realized that I need to say what I need to say and not hold it in and not have those regrets like, oh, I should have said this, and really saying what I know I should do. And if somebody get mad about it, that's their feelings. That's not for me to hold space for. And I think that's something as disabled Black families, we worry so much about, oh, you know, are they going to get upset? Who cares if they get upset? They did something that harmed you or made you uncomfortable, you know, and like a better phrase, screw them, you know, like screw their feelings. And, you know, and you finding ways for you to be empowered in who you are in that moment and saying like, you know what, you did something that was not okay. And I need you to know that. And even if that person blows it off or be like, oh, I'm so sorry. Sometimes bringing things to people's attention really gets them to know like, hey, that's not okay. Because some people go unchecked with some of the wild stuff that they do. So I think for me, just learning how to be more vocal. And at 35, like when you get deep in your 30s, you really start to care less about a lot of things.
Yeah, when Keah was saying she's 29, I turned 30 earlier this year. And it really is a difference. Like, I hate to be that person that, like, yes. I felt it in my spirit, like, woo!
That's real. Like, everybody who has turned 30 after me, they have that switch that comes on. I don't know what it is, but Keah, I cannot wait for that switch to come on for you, because you already getting revved up. But boy, right. It's going to be on full-fledged, and I cannot wait. But I think the older you get, the more that you own that you have a right to be safe. And if you want to be silent, it be on your own terms. And you're going to be loud, that be on your own terms too. And I think that's what I have learned, you know, in growing into myself. And also being in this space as well, to where you have to be loud, or else people think they can go over, yeah, get over on you, can use you, can treat you in a kind of way. Like, being in this space has told me, like, if I don't speak up, people are going to treat me like crap. And I am not going to let you treat me like crap. So let me be loud. So thank you, community, for being how you are, to really allow my voice to get strengthened. Because I think we have to, you know, because that's really important in our work and in the personal.
Yeah, literally survive. We have to use our voices to survive as Black disabled women, let alone to try to thrive out here, but to live, literally just to live.
Exactly. Right.
That's a word.
It really is. Thank you, Brittany, for that. And I just want to say, I am so glad for this conversation. This, you know, if I'm going to spend a Saturday night with anybody, it's going to be with Black disabled women.
Yes.
Being in our joy, talking about our truths and our realities. And I think that's it for us, you know, when it comes to our portion of the panel.
Thank you, Vilissa, for being an awesome moderator, contributor, everything.
Thank y'all.
Yeah, thank you, girl. Did that, okay.
All right, folks, don't go away just yet. We've got some audience questions for our panelists. And if you have one that you didn't ask yet, go ahead and write it in the Q&A box now. In the meanwhile, we will announce the 10 people joining us today who won books. And if we can get the slide up for that. So I'm gonna read these names and also send them into the chat link in just a moment too. And apologies in advance if I mess up your name. Zoya Sahota, Stephanie Ash, Rana Crowder, Melinda Lewis, Leah Kell, Juliet Alexander, Isabel Pelot, Alicia Guidry, Celeste Nguyen, and Armina Halloran. So all of you who won books, congratulations. You get to choose whether you want an ebook, a hard copy paperback, or the audiobook of Disability Visibility, where you can read Keah and Brittany's essay. To claim your book, you have to email me, BEITIKS at sfsu.edu. Or again, you can reply to the Zoom reminder email that you would have gotten. If you did not receive a book winner, if you were not a winner today, there's another chance to win a book very soon. On November 7th, we'll be having our next event at 4 p.m. with Yomi Rong, Patty Byrne, and Leah Lakshmi Pyepsina Samara Sinha. And it will be Disability Justice and Disability Visibility. So save the date for that. We'll be sending more details on how to register. So if we can take the slide down, I will ask, we've gotten a few questions. Will asked, I am a disabled autistic person and I've read the Skin, Tooth and Bone book, the primer that Sins and Ballad put out, to learn more about becoming comfortable talking about disability and intersectionality. What advice can you give me to be better educated on disability and intersectionality? If any of you want to take a stab at that.
I think the first thing is realizing that that term was coined by a Black woman and to understand the origins of intersectionality by Kimberly Crenshaw. I think a lot of groups, not just disabled community, in some ways have co-opted her term, you know, her body of work, and do not know the origins and have just kind of ran with it in some of the ways that we discussed today. So that would be my first direction, is to know what she meant by intersectionality. What was the group that she centered in her body of work when that term was created?
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much what I was going to say too, because a lot of times people use it like it's a buzzword and like, no, it has actual meaning and it was done by a Black woman and she should be respected in these conversations about intersectionality. Like, if you're not talking about her, then your conversation isn't intersectional.
Okay, I've got another one for you. How do you address white people who know the jargon and know what to say, but they don't actually believe in the script they memorized, especially cis white men, if it's obvious that they don't actually follow what they say that they support, and when calling them out turns into an argument?
I try not to speak to them. I'm gonna be honest with you. I don't waste my time, because what happens is they know that they don't believe what they're saying, so it's not my job to convince them. What my job is to do the things that I think will help the community move forward. That's what I want to do. That's not even my job. That's what I want to do. And so talking to somebody that memorizes buzzwords and has a great script down, but I know doesn't actually care, I'm not going to waste my time. I have other stuff to do. Like, I'm not a one-on-one teacher. So, I don't really care about the person that does that. I don't really care to educate them. I don't have the time. There's too much work to be done for me to sit back and be like, oh yeah, let me teach you, person who doesn't care. I need you to care. No, I don't. I need you to get out of the way so that I can get my work done.
You better say that.
So this is a fight that I'm constantly having, because again, I have to work with people. And one thing that I'm big on is like, I'm not gonna explain like basics of racism and XYZ, because the time that we have to spend doing that, like you said, I have other stuff to do. And so, I mean, I think the way that I deal with that is I just do me. I do me, and you either get with it or not. And obviously, that comes with a lot of different compromises, especially depending on, you know, the setting. But like you said, we can't, there's classes for that. I can't personally do it.
No, and nor should you. And honestly, particularly when it comes to online spaces, I don't engage, similar to what Keah was saying. I will block and mute you and go on about my business. If you want to be educated, I have a consulting fee that you can pay to learn from me if it's that serious.
Woo! Don't give away your information and insights for free, y'all. That's so important.
For real. Because everything, particularly with the three of us and so many folks, the information is out there. And it's available for free. It's on blogs. It's on different outlets. You know, we've done podcasts. We've done this. We've done that. So for you to know the jargon and not do the work, you're being willfully obtuse. And if you're going to be willfully obtuse, and I can willfully and willingly ignore you and center on the people that do want to learn, that do want to do better. And I think we have to be honest that a lot of people in this space want the status quo still and will speak the jargon, but know deep in their heart, and we know it too, that they have no inkling to actually do the work. And right, don't waste your time with those people. I think that, you know, it has to come to the point to where we literally have to leave those folks behind and focus on the people that actually do want to do the work.
Yeah, and just because somebody wants to argue with you doesn't mean you have to give them what they want. Just because somebody wants to debate doesn't mean that you have to be a debater. This isn't a debate team. Like, you don't have to do that work. So don't waste your time. They're never worth it. I can promise you that.
No. And in that need to want to debate, they're wanting you to prove your worth and prove your experience. So you don't have to prove that to anybody. You know, your worth is your worth. Your experience is your experience. And if a white disabled person or a non-Black person of color, because they too are problematic, let's keep it real, want to fight you on something or want to say that, oh, why are you centering race, you know, within a conversation, you don't have to educate them. You don't have to give them your time. Time is valuable. And I think in 2020, we have learned the importance of time. We have learned nothing else in this year. And value your time. And in that, you value you and what you give your voice to. And there are plenty of other people and spaces that are worthy of your voice and your time than people who just want to belittle you in a very veiled way.
Thank you all. Can you please discuss invisible disabilities and being Black? One participant asked.
I have CP, which you can see. Get it? Anyway, I have CP and, you know, chronic migraines, seasonal depression, anxiety. I have, you know, invisible disabilities as well. And I think sometimes people believe that one, invisible disabilities aren't as valid as physical, and two, that you can't have both. And so I really try my best to, at least in my work, make sure that people with just invisible disabilities feel like they, you know, can come to me with these sorts of things, or like can see themselves in my work. And I think that I hope that the community as a whole does a better job, you know, especially with the Rona being what it is, in the future, does a better job to acknowledge, to care for, and to discuss invisible disabilities, because it's definitely a conversation that I think the community is very late to having.
Yeah, you know, and for me, I, you know, what people see are my visible disabilities, me being a little woman, me being using a wheelchair, but I'm also hard of hearing. So unless you notice my hearing aids, you're not going to know that. So I think for me, you know, it's kind of in that weird space of people recognize the disabilities that they see, you know, but when it comes to my hard of hearing, I have to tell people, oh, can you speak up? Can you use a mic? And having to advocate for myself in that way to be included in certain spaces, or having to make sure that people think about accessibility that goes beyond the ramps that I use personally. You know, that's something that I've had to really put forth in my work when it comes to talking to organizations about accessibility, especially. I'm like, it's more than just ramps and curb cuts, you know, and really being conscious of that. So in having, you know, living the life of a person with a very visible disability, but also having this invisible one that unless I have to vocalize it, people don't recognize, is something that is very important for my work to really pinpoint, and also ensure that in what I do, you know, folks with invisible or non-apparent disabilities don't feel left out. Because I think that's, you know, some of the conversation of people who are very visible with their disabilities, sometimes being very loud and not giving space to folks with invisible or non-apparent disabilities to really be centered in what we do. Because a lot of our leaders are those with, you know, visible disabilities, and we don't give a lot of space for our leaders and folks with invisible and non-apparent disabilities to share their stories and to really be out there more, kind of like, you know, piggybacking off of what Keah said.
Another participant asked, my experience of the Black community to talk about disability is not acknowledging disability and saying, it's not that bad. You can't talk about it. You just need to work. Have you had this experience? And can you talk about the history of Black community and focus on survival or view as disabled as less than?
I think the Black community's resistance, you know, we have to look at it at a cultural standpoint and historical. And think about how Black bodies in this country, we talk about America, has been treated, and then Black disabled bodies specifically. We have to think about, you know, when it came to slavery, you know, the Black disabled body either being thought as a liability, or, you know, by liability, I mean useless, you know, for the chattel nature of slavery, as well as also being seen as exceptional to be exploited, you know, by certain slave owners who felt like, okay, since you cannot give me your labor, then I can use you for money. I can put you in exhibits, you know, and things of that nature to really monetize your body. So, you know, the Black disabled body in this country has been, you know, abused, has been exploited gravely. And that has, in some ways, impacted how we as Black people view disability from a cultural standpoint of not wanting to have that one more thing on our Black list. You know, and we see that with other identities too, with that resistance to owning another identity label. So for me, when I meet Black folks who are obviously disabled, whether they have visible disabilities or not apparent or invisible ones, for me, I give them grace because I understand how claiming disability is hard. You know, when you don't have that visibility, kind of what we talked about earlier, in a community, when you don't see Black disabled faces, then why would you attach an identity to something that you don't see? Why would you feel a part of a community that you do not see yourself in? So again, that lack of representation has those deep roots that were mentioned earlier as to who claims disability, who feels comfortable with owning the identity, the label of disabled and calling themselves disabled. What does that mean for Black disabled people to have that kind of detachment? Because it's real out here, you know, and I don't know, I just have a lot of grace for people, but that grace does not mean that I excuse the ableism in the Black community. That goes to a point. Because there is stark ableism within the Black community in how we talk about disability, particularly mental illness, where it's really rampant in how we talk about our loved ones and those that we know with mental illness and how people talk about themselves too. But that's just what I do. I just give a lot of people grace and allow them to see me and other people in the work that we do and really start to see it clicking in their head that, oh, this is a community that I'm a part of. This is nothing to be ashamed of. This is nothing to detach myself from or distance myself from. And once people kind of be introduced to it and not be pushed until they're ready, I've seen people really gravitate and start to own that disability identity That's just been my experience.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You pretty much took what I was gonna, like, it was good. I think that, like, piggybacking off of what you said too, we can't expect all Black people to come to disability with open arms when given the history of our lives in this, you know, culture, but also we don't see ourselves even in Black publications specifically. Like, when my book came out, only two Black publications reached out to talk to me about it. And this is like before and after I was doing shows like the Today Show. And so because the community as a whole, and these specifically these media publications, don't see us or our worth, then of course the culture itself isn't, because a lot of the, you know, a lot of the ways in which we see ourselves can come through Black media. And I've always, I try to give people grace. I'm not as good at it as Vilissa is. I'm just not, because I think I get frustrated when I see disability used for like jokes and stuff, specifically on Twitter. I get frustrated because I just don't understand the idea that like you're oppressed too. So why are you further making jokes and oppressing your people? Like, we're your people too. And that's the same thing with, like, you know, movements like the Black Lives Matter movement, and how there were sections of it that like completely ignored disability, and it was Black disabled activists who had to be like, hey, wait a minute, don't forget us. And so just like with any other community, you have to be patient as possible, but also not be afraid to say, hey, you're not centering people that should be centered, or hey, it's us that you're forgetting about. And so I try to be gracious and give people grace, but I also do get frustrated. And I think that frustration is part of the process, but hopefully, you know, when you're doing the work, it doesn't keep you from doing the work just because you're frustrated by it. Cause I feel that urgency to be like, I'm done, but you can't, you know, stop fighting. You just got to keep going.
I agree with everything Vilissa and Keah said, but I just wanted to piggyback on Keah's point about the jokes and stuff like that. It's interesting because I think in this particular moment, we're seeing mental health disabilities become more in vogue, for lack of a better phrase, in the Black community. You see a lot of celebrities talking about mental health, depression, writing books about it and stuff. But I'm wondering, I'm waiting on pins and needles for other types of disabilities to be welcomed in and ushered in. And I have my cynicisms and suspicions as to why that hasn't happened yet. And I think it's rooted in that, and in those notions of like masculinity and appearances and all of these things that we talked about. We talked about rom-coms and all that stuff, but like, you do see certain aspects of disability being talked about more nowadays in the Black community and in communities of color. And I'm just waiting for all the rest of us to also be included in that.
No, that's a great point. You know, even though we extend grace to have patience, accountability is not lacking, you know, and you will be held accountable to. And that responsibility of diversifying disability, and not just those that are more accepting, or like you said, that's in vogue because everybody realizes that, oh, it's okay to talk about this disability. No, there's a wide range of disability, particularly when Black folks have, you know, have a high prevalence of disability. That visibility, those conversations need to be more robust, and not just the disabilities that makes people comfortable. Because honestly, when it comes to mental health, kind of what you were saying, Brittany, it's mainly depression and anxiety that's talked about, not bipolar disorder, not schizophrenia. So even when it comes to the mental health discussions, it's only certain mental illnesses that get the spotlight. And that has to be called out too, because that doesn't do the conversation justice if we cherry pick the ones that we can all kind of understand, you know, loosely, or the ones that makes us comfortable, or whatever that is. So understanding that too, that we're watching which disabilities within certain categories or subgroups are being more comfortable in discussion.
Yep. Well, there are a number of really great additional questions that we do not have time for, which is just a important reminder that we should just have more conversations with you all. So I look forward to keeping it going. Thank you all so much for an incredible and rich conversation today. It was a real honor to get to host it. I'll just make one plug on behalf of Superfest Disability Film Festival, which is coming up next weekend, October 16th, 17th, and 18th. We're kicking off our first day of the festival on Friday with a program that's all about Black disability representation in cinema and a film featuring a Oakland-based poet who received our Disability Justice Award. So a number of the questions we didn't get to were about media representation. And so I just encourage you to come on out for that, and we'll have some, it's a different panel, but great folks to ask that question to as well. So with that, I wish that you could hear a full room of applause and cheering, but thank you all so much. And thanks to all of our participants who joined us on a Saturday afternoon for this conversation. Goodbye, everyone.
Have a good one. Bye, thank you so much.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.